curriculum and professional development. We hear a lot about project or problem-based learning. That is where students are involved working in small groups through a process of inquiry to produce high-quality products or presentations. Activities can mirror the real world, the work of professionals, and move beyond the classroom.
The STEM movement is not going to move standardized testing off the map. But how do you get kids in a project-based environment to excel in standardized testing? And actually, that's what STEMX can do.
We heard an interesting story about a school that took a 100% project-based approach that is now outperforming other schools in the district on standardized tests.
Being able to take risks as leaders and educators and empowering the staff to have some autonomy.
Local planning, connecting to your community-based organizations, connecting to your business and industries, your university outreach programs, and those types of things.
We got feedback from grassroots stakeholders by holding a STEM conference, a statewide STEM summit. And we actually hired professional court transcriptionists. We documented everything everybody said and put it into a kind of a needs assessment report, because then we could say we had a lot of people weighing in, not just teachers, but business leaders, community, and government.
Seeing teachers as really as translators, as intermediaries between industry and students, bringing these two worlds together.
You can't do this alone. It has to be business and industry. And business and industry, they have to be a part of it because they have a greater voice in advocating, because it's a workforce development solution.
My school actually pushed STEM back into the home through a parent challenge, a bag that goes home with a challenge in it, and the kids teach their parents the entire design process. And so parents are learning that it's not like how you went to school at one time. Children use the design process to determine how they're going to learn.
Beth and I were good friends. Beth is in Arizona, but I can't pick her plan up and do it just like Arizona. I have to do it the way that Texas may need to do it, and then you have to boil it down even more. You have to do it the way your region needs it done.
So what we ultimately developed was a framework that educators could use, which really lays out a strategy for converting an existing school into a STEM-focused school. The STEM Immersion Guide, which is what we call our tool, looks at how do you immerse STEM into schools at four different levels. Exploratory, which is really focused on after school, out of school, and activities that are outside of the regular curriculum. Moving into the fourth level, which we call full immersion, where it is totally a student-directed, teacher-facilitated, project-based approach.
So our blueprint tool really talks about, in the seven pieces, what's the mission, how do you change the culture, how are you going to be able to sustain your model or your design? And also, who are the influencers?
The North Carolina STEM Attributes and Rubric Tool really is a checklist of characteristics that help define programmatic quality. And that's a huge issue for all of us. What is a quality program? How do we define that? What are the exemplars for it? So they have come up with 10 attributes adopted by the State Department of Education in North Carolina.
About 3.5 years ago, maybe 4 years ago, there was 20 of us sitting in a basement in Raleigh, North Carolina, talking about STEM education. And today there's 700 people here in Austin, Texas.
Don't go it alone. It makes no sense to go it alone.
It's a notion that all of us are smarter than one of us. We have to make sure our kids are prepared. We have to make sure that our kids can get a decent job. The best part about it is most of these schools, if not all of them, demonstrate this with kids that everybody said couldn't do this. Kids can do this, and you have to be able to see it, taste it, and touch it.